Today, we have 290 lactating cows. Currently, we have an average production of 40 liters per cow per day, which is the general average, delivering approximately 11,500 liters. Today, we are still working with two milking sessions, so this average of 40 liters is based on two milkings. This corresponds to almost 5 liters of milk per kilogram of concentrate. This production ensures an average daily gain of 1,200 grams per day.
Welcome everyone to our channel. Today we are here with Jasmine and Ranieri at Santa Elmira Farm. We're going to show you their management practices. They are currently transitioning. Their freestall is almost ready, so they are moving the cows from the compost barn to the freestall. We will likely record another video once it is fully completed. Jasmine showed us their management practices. We visited the milking parlor, talked about nutrition, and discussed the calves. I hope you enjoy this video. Subscribe to our channel, give us a like, and enjoy the video.
My name is Jasmine, and I am a veterinarian here at Santa Elmira Farm. I started working here in July 2022, so it has been almost 2.5 years. When we started, the farm had 240 lactating cows, and today we have 290 lactating cows. Currently, we have an average production of 40 liters per cow per day, as a general average, delivering approximately 11,500 liters per day. The average milk quality has been around 3.7% fat and 3.3% protein. The somatic cell count, SCC, is around 250,000, and the total bacterial count, TBC, is approximately 4,000 to 5,000 per month. Today, we are still working with two milking sessions, so this average of 40 liters is based on two milkings. We have 8 employees, one responsible for feeding, one who handles feeding during milking, bedding maintenance, and cleaning the alley. 3 women work in the milking parlor. One woman takes care of the calves, and 2 employees handle general services and assist me with animal management. So, in a way, it's a lean and optimized team focused on milk production per employee. The management is streamlined for 2 milkings, but next year the farm faces a new challenge with the new facilities. We plan to start the 3rd milking session to further improve production, and in the future, we plan to move these cows to a free stall, which is currently under construction in the background. It will feature sand bedding. Once we move the cows to the free stall and allow for their adaptation period, we intend to implement the 3rd milking session. This is the milking parlor at Santa Elmira Farm. It is a 20-stall system from Gier. Typically, the employees work in sections, dividing the milking parlor into 3 parts, and each person handles the entire milking routine for their assigned cows. The process starts with pre-dipping, followed by stripping the first 3 streams of milk, performing another pre-dipping, drying the teats, and then attaching the milking unit. Currently, the milking process also monitors the cow's milk production. We use these tags, which are electronic buttons provided by the state's traceability system. We are not yet using monitoring collars. My monitoring system relies on the milk production data that the machine transmits to Gear's computer software. This allows me to access daily milk production information for all the animals. These are the facilities we currently have for the animals. Here is the barn for the calves, and we have also improvised a prepartum area for heifers. Over there is the barn for cows in groups 1 and 2, which include high-producing primiparous and multiparous cows. We also have a prepartum area for the cows. The compost barn management here is very simple and streamlined. It is done twice a day, where the bedding is turned twice daily using a rotary harrow. The feed alley is also cleaned twice a day, during both milkings. The water troughs are cleaned regularly as well. Feeding is provided in 2 sessions per day, once in the morning during the first milking and again in the afternoon. We always aim to have fresh feed available when the cows return from milking. One challenge we currently face on the farm is stocking density. With the herd's growth, we have become limited in space, resulting in overstocking in the compost barn. We have noticed that the feed bunk space is not as ideal as we would like, and the bedding area is also facing challenges. However, with the drier weather now that summer is approaching, conditions have been a bit more manageable compared to the winter.
The diet is very simple. We try to minimize labor costs as much as possible. We are also working to reduce the need for ingredients that are not produced on the farm. We mainly use corn silage, cottonseed, a mix prepared by a local cooperative, and a blend of bypass soybean meal and canola meal. These are just a few ingredients. Recently, we added a bit of winter silage to reduce the reliance on corn silage, which has been a bit tight, and the farm has grown significantly. Initially, we calculated corn silage consumption based on the number of animals we had at the time. As the farm expanded, production increased as well. The demand for silage also grew, forcing us to supplement with some winter silage to help reduce corn silage consumption. The diet is very straightforward and streamlined. There's not much complexity to it. Currently, we are working with approximately 28% starch, crude protein at 17% for the primiparous group, and 18% for the multiparous group. We do not have a post-fresh group.
Today, we work with three groups. One group of primiparous cows, one group of multiparous cows, and a low production group. After calving, they are assigned directly to either the primiparous or multiparous group. We do not have a post-fresh group. They go directly into these groups. We try to keep them in their respective groups until they reach at least 200 days in milk. After that, we reallocate them based on space availability, milk protein levels, pregnancy status, and DIM. In the future, with the freestall, we will have to reorganize into four groups. I will need to distribute the cows more evenly across the groups. As for their feed, the total mixed ration is mainly composed of corn silage with a small amount of oat silage. It also includes a protein concentrate that comes pre-mixed with all additives, such as buffers, mineral salts, adsorbents, cottonseed, and extruded soybean meal with canola. Basically, it's a very simple diet. The farm's goal is to produce high-quality forage, specifically high-quality corn silage. We aim to achieve the right chop length and good dry matter content to reduce the need for concentrates and optimize milk production per unit of concentrate fed. By producing high-quality forage on the farm, especially corn silage with a high starch content, we can achieve good feed conversion efficiency in these animals. The group of multiparous cows, for example, is currently averaging 50 liters. These animals consume around 11 kilograms of concentrate per day. This results in nearly 5 liters of milk per kilogram of concentrate, which is an excellent feed conversion rate. This is what we strive for on the farm. Productive animals that generate profitability for the operation. We have staff working along the feed bunk, managing ventilation, and also in the holding area. We prioritize having more staff in the holding area than at the feed bunk because the cows still walk to the milking parlor. We focus on ensuring they cool down before milking, but we also have staff assigned to the feed bunk area. This is the calf rearing area here at Santa Elmira Farm. We work with two systems. Calves stay in individual hutches until they are 21 days old. After 21 days, they move to the group system, which uses an automatic feeder. We have two automatic feeder pens, each capable of feeding up to 50 calves, 25 on each side. The calves are grouped based on size and space, with the larger ones in one section and the smaller ones in another. In the back, we have two post-weaning paddocks, where the calves stay before being moved outside. When a calf is born, it is placed in these hutches, where it receives colostrum 4 liters. The navel is treated, and the calf is kept warm. We have hutches equipped with heat lamps to warm the calves during colder days. Calves remain in these hutches until they are 21 days old. During this period, they are fed 7 liters of milk per day, 3.5 liters in the morning, and 3.5 liters in the afternoon. The milk is milk replacer powder, prepared at a concentration of 140 grams per liter, 14%. After 21 days, they move to the group system, where they continue to receive milk replacer powder via the automatic feeder. The feeder can handle up to 50 calves, 25 in each section. It identifies each calf through an electronic tag, similar to the system used for milking cows, and dispenses a preset daily volume of milk. In this group system, the calves are fed 7.5 liters of milk replacer daily, also prepared at a 14% concentration. From the first day in the hutches, calves have access to water and pelleted feed containing 24% crude protein. This feed is available in both the individual hutches and the group pens. It is offered from the first day of life, allowing the calves to gradually learn to eat and increase their intake over time. Here we have the weaned animals. We also have two post-weaning paddocks, which are separated by size. However, these paddocks are currently overcrowded, thankfully. We have plenty of calves. These animals receive the same diet as the high-producing multi-paris group. So, the same total mixed ration prepared for the cows is offered to them here, ensuring an average daily gain of 1.2 kilograms per day. The plan, once the cows move to the free stall, is to use the compost barn currently housing the cows for the heifers. This will allow us to improve the available space, move some animals there, and reduce overcrowding here. The animals currently outside will be relocated to this barn. We will set up paddocks with partitions and enclosures to create groups based on size until they are ready for insemination. They will remain in the barn at least until they are pregnant. Here, we also have an improvised prepartum area for heifers. On the other side, we have the prepartum area for cows. We bring them in 21 days before calving. During this period, their prepartum diet is mainly corn silage, wheat straw, and a prepartum concentrate. We also include choline and methionine additives in the prepartum diet. Reproductive management on the farm is conducted every 15 days. All cows are pre-synchronized. We start pre-synchronization at 40 days postpartum for primiparous cows and at 30 days postpartum for multiparous cows to ensure insemination, around 60 days in milk for multiparous cows and around 70 days DIM for primiparous cows. We primarily use fixed-time artificial insemination and employ heat detection patches to monitor estrus. We do not use monitoring collars. Instead, we rely on heat detection patches to identify return heats, and the rest of the reproductive program is based primarily on fixed-time artificial insemination. This approach has worked very well for the farm, starting from pre-synchronization and continuing with the use of fixed-time artificial insemination. It fits well with the farm's management style, our team, and my oversight. We build our routine around the cows' schedules, and this has brought good results for us. We are closing 2024 with a 59% service rate, 38% conception rate, and 22% pregnancy rate. Of course, these results can improve significantly, but they are already better than the results we had in 2023. We expect even better results in 2025, although we face challenges like heat stress during the summer. If we separate the results by season, conception rates vary greatly. For example, since May, the conception rate has been 47%, compared to the annual average of 38%. We constantly aim to improve these numbers while minimizing the impact of heat stress on reproduction. Heifers are inseminated starting at 13 months of age and weighing 380 to 400 kilograms. We use sexed semen for heifers during the first and second inseminations, For lactating cows, we used a different strategy this year. We used sexed semen for primiparous cows during the winter period from June through November and achieved better results. Last year, we used sexed semen for both primiparous and multiparous cows during the winter on the first insemination, but we saw a significant difference. This year, we opted to use sexed semen only for primiparous cows during the first insemination, and the results have been very promising.
I have been using this device quite frequently on farms. I take measurements every 5 meters along the feed alley to assess the uniformity of the mix. With it, I can analyze dry matter, crude protein, starch, neutral detergent fiber, acid detergent fiber, and ash. I also use it to analyze silage, haylage, and raw materials. We formulate the diet after analyzing the raw materials. The feeder then prepares the mixes, and we analyze the total mixed ration on the same day. This means we leave here with the entire diet ready. Before starting the analysis, I calibrate the device. The results are sent immediately to my cell phone. The device uses near-infrared reflectance to measure the values and averages the data from 6 scans. Afterward, the results are displayed on the cell phone. Here, I have the diet results, dry matter at 42% in the multiparous group, starch at 29.2%, acid detergent fiber at 18.4%, ether extract at 5%, crude protein at 16.9%, and ash at 0.7%, 8%.
Here will be the future facilities for the cows. It is a free stall with sand bedding and a flushing system. There will also be a settling area for sand recovery and a biodigester to utilize the manure for energy production. This free stall will have the capacity to house 300 lactating cows. We chose the free stall instead of the compost barn because our region is very humid. Managing a compost barn is quite challenging, especially in the winter. In this region, we have 2 reservoirs located very close by. So, in addition to rain during winter, we also deal with a lot of fog and humidity. This makes it difficult to dry the bedding, especially with a stocking density that would not be ideal for the compost barn. That's why we opted for the free stall, to provide greater comfort for the animals and also to make the work easier for the team. Since all this work is carried out by people, we want to ensure the cows are cleaner when they arrive at the milking parlor. This will make the job easier for the women in the milking parlor, helping us maintain healthier and more productive animals. The free stall system is also designed to simplify tasks for everyone on the farm, improving both workflow and results.